we've got a lot of stuff going on this time of year, and so it's good to see people that take the time to come to an event like this. The world is run by those who show up, and I think this is another example of why we need to show up. South Dakota is kind of known as a test ground for a lot of bad stuff to get on the ballot. And I'm chasing a bunny before I even get started, but you know, there's been a lot of talk in the legislature about doing something to make it more difficult to get things on the ballot. I've always been pretty reluctant to support issues of that nature because, you know, I think that's one of the things that makes South Dakota great. It has the claim of fame being the first state in the union that had the initiative measure process, but it also, because of that, it's easy to get things on the ballot, so it's really important for people to stay engaged and involved and informed. There are a lot of things, in my opinion, that are wrong with initiative measure 22. I am going to focus on some of the more significant things. And I think far and away the biggest issue in my mind, and I think the one that strikes a chord with the voters, the clearest, is taxpayer funding campaigns. One of the key components within initiative measure 22 is to establish these coupons, $250 coupons for each registered voter in the state. Now, if you do the math, 520,000 registered voters, $100 each, that's $52 million. Well, the amount is capped at $12 million. That in and of itself is pathetic because the proponents are saying there's going to be a very low participation rate, less than 25%. Well, it started from a failed policy to start with. Beyond that, everyone, 100% of the taxpayers in South Dakota have the privilege of paying for that 20% to give money to pay for robocalls and attack ads. And that's all part of politics, we understand that. But I think it's a huge step. Now we're going to set a policy that forces taxpayers to pay for that campaign. So, you know, we could talk about that all night, but that is a huge issue, and I think it's the one that will, as opponents to 22, that we need to be loud and clear with the public because it strikes home to people. The other thing I talk about on the 12 million, because in my 14 years in the legislature, anytime you come to peer with an issue, some of you might remember Representative Putnam. He was chair of appropriation for years. Great guy, very conservative. But he would always, every time we had a new class, when I was majority leader, I'd have him get up and give his little speech talking about spenders and bleeders. Spenders were initiated measure 22 as a spender, $12 million in new spending. More than just 12 million, we'll talk about that later. So it's a spender. A bleeder was if like you repealed an existing revenue stream, that would be a bleeder. So in the three governors that I've served alongside, Janglow, Rounds, and Dugard, over a 14-year period, I don't know how many times, and times I got pretty sick of hearing it, identify a funding source. You got a spender, where's the money come from? South Dakota has a reputation nationally as being doing government on the cheap. And I wear that as a badge of honor. For the last 14 years, have been ranked in the top three for the most tax-friendly states in the nation. I don't know where we're going to rank after the last 2 years. Another conversation for another day. But the fact of the matter is, $12 million is not chump change in South Dakota. In other states, it would be a rounding error. Not so in South Dakota. I want somebody to tell me where that money's going to come from. Because it's not there. It's not built into the budget. It will come from schools. It will come from highways. It comes from someplace. So none of that's identified. I will talk about a little more, not just as all phones are on the subject. I had a conversation with Chantel Krebs, the Secretary of State, the other day, talking about this issue specifically. Because on the funding side of it, It doesn't, that's all it talks about, it's $12 million. Well, you set up this ethics commission, it's also part of the bill. 34 pages of new rules and regulations and bureaucracy. She estimates between 5 and 7 new full-time employees or full-time equivalents, FTEs, in order for her office to deal with the stuff that's contained and initiated manual 22. That's huge. That's another, I think it's roughly $70,000 per FTE. But it doesn't even talk about all the other incidentals that will come as a result of it. Again, 34 pages of new legislation. The next point, I guess, that I would talk about is the expansion of government. I mentioned that creates an ethics commission. That's another bureaucracy of unelected officials that are put in place to oversee our elections, I guess. I've read the bill. How many of you have read the bill? 34 pages. Man, you guys are some diehards, because that's some tough slogging. I made it through, but I was kind of rubbing my eyes by the time we got done. So it sets up a new layer of bureaucracy, a commission. But what I've yet to see in looking through this or in the comments of the proponent is, what does it resolve? What does that commission do? What are the ethics? They throw out these phrases like corruption and state government and putting limits. Identify the corruption. If you nail them down, then we'll talk about ED5, the issues with Bender who committed suicide, or you all know the news story from a couple years ago. They talk about the GERA. We know the tragedy that took place because of the GERA. Both of those are federal programs. There was definitely a criminal activity in both of those cases. Both those cases was investigated and dealt with. I believe, some people don't. But regardless of your opinion, what took place there, nothing in IM 22 would have done anything to address it. It does lower the funding caps. I did an interview with NPR just before this started, and he asked me about that, whether I thought lowering those caps was a good idea. Well, it was interesting because just a few years ago, we went through a major rewrite in our campaign finance laws. It took about 3 years to get it through the legislature. The first year it was brought up, it was brought up by the minority party at the Capitol. And once again, the process we go through, we went through a year of hearings and amendments and public hearings and committee hearings and set it on the table. Came back the next year after more public input and more vetting. And after 3 years, we rewrote the campaign finance law. It is not easy to get something done. And what we did, we actually raised the limits. It was $250 for a statewide race, we raised it to $1,000. I supported that. And so did many in the minority party, the majority, I think, in the minority party. Because my view was, and shared by many, I don't care how much you give somebody. I just want to know who you're giving it to and how much you're giving them. As a matter of free speech, giving money is a matter of free speech. You know, it might be appropriate to put some kind of limits on it, but I think transparency is the key, and that's what we focused on in what we did, was transparency. And I would have to say, from a realistic standpoint, I know people throw out terms like corruption and all this stuff, that's how bad state governments have become, but I'll tell you what, never in the history of the state has our government been more transparent at the state level. Look at our committee processes. Everything is recorded. Everything is done in front of a live mic. Every bill is posted 24 hours, 48 hours in advance after a hearing. The public is invited to testify. So I'm preaching a little bit, but in 14 years in the legislature, I have been extremely impressed with how user-friendly our process is, especially when people get involved that haven't been before, and they're amazed at how friendly the legislature is for public input. And I just say that because it troubles me when I hear people, especially the proponents, that that are funded from out of state, coming into South Dakota and throwing out these wild-eyed allegations of corruption at the state level. Well, I'm not saying it doesn't happen, but I will say one thing is a fact in Pierre. Nothing stays a secret. And I was thinking about examples. I think all the press is gone. I remember one night toward the tail end of the session, pretty contentious issues, and Bill Napoli was in the Senate, I was in the House, and we got in a little discussion and skirmish at one of the receptions after session one night, and I don't know if I followed him to the parking lot or he followed me, but we had a pretty frank discussion in the parking lot. After the meeting was over, the next day, so happened that I and a group of other people had a meeting with the governor, so we were waiting in his outer office, and his schedule came out, and she pointed at me, she wanted me to come back, so I went back to the governor's office, and we walked in, he shut the door, he says, tell him about this fight you had with Napoli last night. And there was no witnesses, so I didn't know. But that's an example of how work doesn't appear. So I'm kind of getting off track. The other thing, the last thing that I'll talk about, I've already talked longer than I planned on, but the last thing that I wanted to talk about, because it's kind of slipped, it just kind of goes past people, and we talked a little bit about it, but 34 pages of new law. We've talked about what it takes in the legislature, what we went through with the rewrite of our campaign finance laws, 3 years. And I would say that there wasn't maybe 3 pages of new language contained in that rewrite that it took us 3 years to pass. This is 34 pages of new laws. I mentioned that early on when I joined with AFP and agreed to be on the No on 22 campaign committee. And I brought that to Ben Lee's attention. 34 pages, I've had enough experience to know if you do not write 34 pages of legislation, I don't care who, without some serious issues. Well, an outfit called Center for Competitive Politics, I think they're based out of Washington, D.C., but they're kind of a watchdog group for First Amendment rights. And they wrote a 10-page analysis. They had one of their foremost authorities, attorneys on campaign finance laws, do a review of IM-22. That's what I have here, 10 pages. It wasn't as difficult to read as the 34 pages in the bill, but it still took some effort. And I won't even get into this, but it's 10 pages of concerns that they brought forth. They made it very clear that they were trying to keep a neutral perspective on. But they identified 10 pages of problems. I wanted to just read one paragraph out of here that I thought was beneficial for this group. It says, the sheer length and complexity of Initiative Measure 22, which purports to regulate every South Dakotan's core First Amendment right, also poses serious constitutional questions. It took the author of this analysis, an attorney who specializes in this type of campaign finance and lobbying laws, addressed in this initiated measure, more than 5 hours to read and reread the measure in order to understand its provisions. Professional attorney, 5 hours to read this. And I lied. There's one other area that I wanted to touch on, because in these 10 pages of concerns, there's some of them that aren't just a little problem, they're huge problems. And they're unworkable. The one that I wanted to read here, because I think it probably would affect one of the people in attendance, Dale Barcher, is the executive director for Family Heritage Alliance, which is a 501c3
and a 4.
501c3 and a 4. I'll read this section. It says, some of the unexpected change may be a function of drafting errors or omissions in the measure's language, while others may be deliberate. As discussed in more detail below, here are some of the concerns that include even speech that is objectively nonpartisan, such as neutral voter guides on the legislator advocacy communication, asking the public to contact their elected representatives about an official matter, would require a sponsor to affirmatively declare that they either support or oppose a candidate mentioned in the communication. Many of the groups that sponsor such communication may have policies or operate under a section of the federal code, 501c3, that bar the group from making such an endorsement, subjecting their organization to a catch-22 situation. And I would guess that that would put you squarely in the middle of that.
Well, it would be a problem with us. With the C4, we can, of course, name a candidate that we're endorsing, but oftentimes in C4, we choose not to name candidates, but rather just their position. This would be a problem for us.
Yeah, plus it would violate, I mean, it makes no sense. You're doing voter guides, take a neutral perspective, just giving the facts. You know, obviously you want to avoid endorsement in those cases. But, like I said, that was just one of the concerns. As I talked to the Secretary of State and some of our official staff, Legislative Research Council, they are gravely concerned about the ambiguity of the language and just the problematic areas that they've seen in just reviewing the 34 pages. But I could go on and on and on. But I would like to take questions and discussion. We could talk amongst us girls.
Larry, any internal polling yet being done in the state on 22?
I don't believe so. Not that I'm privy to it, at least. Whether or not the proponents are doing some. I did hear rumblings of some more informal polling a few weeks ago after, you know, on the test message of the taxpayer-funded campaigns that showed that that was striking a pretty strong chord with the public. I've not seen anything myself to verify that.
Could you mention some of the coalition members?
Yes.
Absolutely. That's next on my agenda, but there's a growing coalition of people, organizations supporting them, and I'll just go through the list. We started South Dakota Retailers, South Dakota Chamber of Commerce, FHA Coalition, Family Heritage Alliance, South Dakota Farm Bureau, CWA, which is Concerned Women of America, South Dakota Cooperatives, Western Dakota Families. That's my wife's organization. They threw them in there early when they were looking for Patty. AFP, which is American for Prosperity. AGC is Associated General Contractors, South Dakota Land Improvement Contractors, South Dakota Agribusiness, South Dakota Grain and Feed Association, Minnehaha GOP, and the Sioux Falls Area Chamber of Commerce. They were the last members to join on.
And the reason why a number of them have jumped on is the very thing that you just said. A number of them put out a C3 voter guide on their particular issue. This would muzzle any type of C3 voter guide.
So is it anybody in favor of it?
Well, yeah. In fact, the proponents are, you know, it's widely held that it was, you know, Rick Weiland that was kind of the moving force behind it. But the proponents are quick to list name a list of Republicans that support the proponent side of Initiative Measure 22. Don Frankenfeld, I'm going to do an event with him next week. He's one of the local proponents of the measure. And it's scary to me because, you know, you can do sound bites that play to the public. You know, the allegations of corruption are really troubling to me, and we talked about that because people like believing the worst, and it's easy to convince people that we have a corrupt government, especially with the national politics and the flavor of the conversation there. Great.
I thought something else before another question. Those Republicans that would Democrats that missed the spring. They're Roundup resistant. Anyway, I'm a big fan of our Republican, our Republic form of government, where we democratically elect representatives and send them to do this work. If something like this were brought up in session, would it have a chance of mustering its way through a committee, two committees, and two House chambers? And if, I'm thinking no. So you favor going back to a democracy. Sidestepping that's what initiated measure, in my mind, correct me if I'm wrong, but in my mind, initiated measure is saying to the elected democratically elected republic system that we have here, you can't do the job, we're going to do it democratically, and we're going to have everybody vote. And the reason we have a republic form of government is because democracies, the majorities are often wrong. And
yeah.
So,
yeah,
I have never been a fan of initiated measures. If you can't get it done in session, then, or if you don't like what the people in session are doing, then quit re-electing those people in.
Yeah.
Or elect the ones that you need to get something done.
Yeah, I see what you're saying. And to tie in with that, I go a step farther because it's everybody voting on it, the democracy.
The democracy.
And it sets up one of the big key provisions, setting up a commission of non-elected people.
Exactly.
And giving them power.
And besides, the general public is not going to inform themselves on 10 different issues on the ballot.
Yeah, spooky, especially like I said, 34
pages. I mean,
pages.
You know, some of us are going to read that 34 pages. That's just one issue.
There's a Frankman that said that the democracy is two wolves and a lamb voting on what to have for dinner.
Yeah.
On this Center for Competitive Politics and that 10 pages that you got,
yeah.
Is there a way for us to be able to get a copy of that?
Sam, do you know? I know that this is, it was sent to me, and I printed it off. I went to Dakota War College, and they had a blurb on it. And so I just took it off of that.
Who was the author of that again?
Eric Wang was a senior fellow that's the writer on it. You know, and that's why I listed the list of coalition members. We're building support within the state. The opposition, I believe, Sam, maybe you can help me out. I recall they had one contributor. It was from Massachusetts, and it was to the tune of 284,000. You know, and so that. That source, I don't think, was identified. Of course, AFP has been taking a very strong role in helping set up the feed 22. But beyond that, that's just a starting point. We want to build support within the organization, you know, by word of mouth, the grassroots. Go to our website, sign up. Sam's going to talk about some of that stuff in a little bit. But we're that's the purpose of these meetings, is to build some grassroots support and opposition.
Larry, you said that you're going to debate Don here next week. Would that be at the League of Voters in Sioux Falls?
No, at the Rotary.
Oh, here?
Rapid City Rotary, here in Rapid City.
Which Rotary meeting? Morning? Noon?
It's... I think it's at 11 o'clock.
Okay, it's a noon meeting. They have two meetings in Rapids.
Are you in the Rotary?
Nope.
Linda was smiling on his face.
Just think that you had your calendar right with you.
Yep. I'm kind of a techie guy.
Where's that?
At the Rotary place.
I sure hope you got an invitation.
My schedule, she'll be detailed up.
That is going to be a hunk of dumpy's wallet.
Yes.
So why would you need taxpayer?
Well.
Oh, why can't you go out and inform people that it's a tax thing? More taxes, a little fund.
Well.
Political control.
And that's exactly right, and that's why.
Just what we all want, more taxes.
Yep. And this is the message that plays. You know, it's hard to convey the significance of a 34 page rewrite, so I could talk more about that than actually this. This is what plays to the fact of the average South Dakota. And their message is, you know, you want your tax dollars being used to pay for robocalls and tax dollars.
Larry, has the Republican Party taken a stand on 22 statewide or county?
Yes. I think, I didn't go to the state convention this year, but they passed a resolution in opposition to 22 and a number of the other measures.
So why does it have to be a Republican Democrat? Can it just be a tax?
You know, it doesn't. In fact, I got a call from Doug Sonke a week or two ago. Doug's the president of South Dakota Farmers Union. And of course, it's easy to connect dots. You know, you look at all these measures and you see a common thread and you think it's whatever. So, but he called me to ask me, Farmers Union is a outspoken supporter of the redistricting.
Oh.
Setting up a commission, so it's nonpartisan redistricting. So he called me up, he says, you're a fair guy and you like doing, setting politics aside, policy over politics. So I want to know if you'd join us in support of that. I said, no, why would you think that? But I was probably a little more on edge toward him than I should have been, because as we got into the conversation, I was assuming that they were kind of in bed with the rest of the coalitions on some of these other members. And as I talked to him about some of the stuff, he sounded pretty flabbergasted at some of the stuff that was on the ballot. I think, like, and I'm not speaking for him, but just what I gathered, that he was a big proponent of IM 22 or some of the other stuff. And they kind of got caught and washed because, you know, they felt that was the right thing to do, and they had their own reasons. But, so it's kind of a mess as far as sorting through it. But all the more reason, you know, we're here to talk about IM 22, but obviously there's a lot of stuff on the ballot. We all need to be very active in getting informed and doing our part to get the word out.
If this were met, and it really does, how does it actually work? How would the money actually be spent? Because, you know, the reason I'm asking, I've been describing this to people as like, to me, I always thought it was like a backdoor way to get the fast to get money, because they can't raise money the other way.
Yep.
So I
want to
know if I'm correct in saying that, but I mean, how
exactly does it work? Yeah, well, the way it worked, and you know, just reading the bill, it's set up with that each citizen, a registered voter, would get two $50 coupons. I don't know if they would be an actual physical coupon that would be sent to them. I don't know how that's, you know, I suppose a lot of that would be set up by rule or Secretary of State would invest. And then you'd have the option, you receive your coupons, you'd have the option of either pitching them in the trash can or designating them to sign them over to Sandy who's running for it. What is that? Yeah. You designate the candidate you want that $50 to go to and physically give that coupon and then they can redeem it. The candidate in turn, I believe, would then they'd be restricted on, you know, if they're receiving coupons up. And somebody correct me if they're wrong, because I, you know, I didn't study this at length because it's kind of beside the point, some of the details. But you know, they could redeem them, but then they're subject to other restrictions on other money that they can raise. But I don't know how that all plays out.
You know, one of the concerns I had about it is so many of the uninformed voters, all right, they get two $50 vouchers. And if they don't use them, what happens to the money?
Well, the money wouldn't be accounted for until it's redeemed.
Right. Okay, so if it's not redeemed, you know, you've got that money that's been set aside, you know, out of taxpayer money has been set aside. Is it going to open up another door for legislators to go, hey, we've got this $12 million over here that, you know, the campaign finances didn't take care of. Let's use this money for this. Yeah. Just like the Social Security and a few other, you know, that's one of the concerns I have. When you're talking $50 million.
Well, it's capped at 12 million.
So why would, if it's capped at 12 million, why would they say every voter gets 50 bucks?
Every voter gets $100.
Right, every voter gets $100.
Which would be $52 million. But the proponents are estimating that they'll no more than 25-22% of the math works out to will actually participate in it. So it's only going to be 12 million. If it's more than 12 million, it seems like it was the language stated that if it was more than 12 million, then they'd prorate.
Yes.
But it's capped at 12 million.
But everybody gets an opportunity if they give someone their vouchers.
Yep.
But when the vouchers come in.
Yep. Feels like everybody getting a coupon for a 50-cent watermelon.
Well, the first vouchers to come in will be redeemed at 12 million in reach.
Well, that's a good question. I don't know, because then you couldn't prorate it because you'd already allocated the money.
Yeah, I didn't state that.
And that was some more of the problems that was contained in there. And the 12-page or the 10-page letter was even the language on how those coupons are used is so ambiguous that the author of that didn't know whether it would, the way he read it, the coupons would only apply to new candidates. New voters will qualify for the coupon. If you registered vote, you get the coupons. If you were already voted or you're an old timer like you, you'd just be
well,
out
of
the cold.
Well, then I don't think you're going to worry about reaching 520 million. That's good.
And you understand that portion of that bill as to how the voucher were, because it was, I did at one point in reading it going, okay, is this all in the new book? You know, if I go in as a precinct meeting woman, I go and get somebody registered to vote, is that the only person that's going to get it? Like, I've been voting for my whole life, and I'm not going to get one of those vouchers?
Yeah, well,
that was one of the things that I had to read it three or four times, and I still didn't understand if it was just for that.
Well, you were in good company, because the author of that white paper was unclear on that, too. The way he read it, you had to be a new voter to qualify. So there's just, you know, there's all kinds of, aside from the obvious, just the policy of taxpayer-funded elections, which is the big, aside from that, you get down the weeds, there's just all kinds of problems.
Remember, the funding source hasn't been central.
Right.
You know, so we're in the realm of, we have to pass it to see what it says.
Yeah.